these higher results, to have this sattvic approach? Well, first of all, we do need allies. We do need friendship. We do need the alliance of other people, spiritual people, like-minded people. In the Hindu thought, we put a great emphasis on the principle of association. According to the people we associate with, that draws us in the same direction in life. So we have the principle of satsanga, communication, communion with like-minded spiritual people. So I had to find communities and friends of a like-minded nature in order to cultivate those things in myself. It would have been very difficult to achieve that entirely by myself. Now, at the same time, it's not always possible to have the friends and associations of a like-minded spiritual nature. So you can also, or what I also did, I studied the books and the teachings. I traveled, went to places, studied with different teachers, and then I tried to introduce a more sattvic lifestyle into my own daily life. The sattvic food, the more vegetarian, pranic, you know, vitally energized food, following a daily lifestyle in which there was study, meditation, pranayama, mantra, spiritual practice, spending time in nature. Nature is a great way to increase the sattva guna, hiking, gardening. When I was younger, I also worked with plants. I've gotten involved in the medical field, helping others, finding a vocation that increases the sattva guna. I tried to consider all the factors and set in motion a domination of factors that increases the sattva guna. You can't be pure totally. You have all aspects of human life. Sattva guna also requires that we are flexible, that we are receptive to others, that we are not judgmental, that we are not puritanical, and that we are not condemning other people, that we are following a more natural lifestyle and an openness and adaptability in our application of these spiritual practices. So I've also tried to do that. And above all, maintain good humor. One of the foundations of sattva guna is to have good humor in life, to have inner contentment, to look at the bright side of things, to try to look at the better side of people, the better side of what is going on in the world without giving up your discrimination or intelligence, but to try to bring in the light and to look for the higher forces that are always there. At a physical level, the most important things we can do to develop sattva guna are the right diet, appropriate diet, and appropriate exercise. The appropriate diet for developing sattva guna is considered to be a predominantly vegetarian diet, because that is bringing in food that has more prana. And also, one of the key principles of sattva guna is the principle of ahimsa, or nonviolence. So that if in our diet we're promoting ahimsa, or non-harming of other creatures, then the food that we take in also has that quality. You know, if we are eating a lot of food from animals who have been killed prematurely, who have been slaughtered from slaughterhouses, their energy, their emotions, their hormones are also coming in with that as well, and the negativity of that experience. So it's considered that the foundation for developing sattva guna at a physical level is a vegetarian diet, now, or at least a predominantly vegetarian diet. If you can't be a total vegetarian, at least you can predominate in the vegetarian food. In fact, it's found that a predominantly vegetarian diet promotes health overall. And then the other thing at a physical level is our exercise, how we move. And yoga was devised as a sattvic form of exercise, a form of exercise that is calming, harmonizing, balancing, that promotes equanimity, that relaxes us, that allows us to release stress and tension. So to develop sattva guna at a physical level, we need a diet and an exercise system which helps us do that. And the yogic diet, the Ayurvedic diet, and the yogic system of exercise are devised specifically for that purpose. We have to understand that who we are at a physical level is the product of what we eat. You know, just as any machine, the fuel you put into it depends upon how it's going to run. And food has various qualities that are going to affect not only the body, but also the nervous system and also the mind. So if we eat food that is very heavy, oily, fried, very, you know, sugary, salty, these have a dulling effect on the body, and they also have a dulling effect upon the mind. If we eat food that is very hot, stimulating, spicy, has sharper qualities, then this will have a stimulating effect, but also possibly irritating effect upon the body and the nervous system. If we eat food that is very mild, you know, fruit, vegetables, whole grains, these will have a more calming effect upon the body, the nervous system, and indirectly the mind. So our health, you know, diet is the key to our health, but it's also crucial to our mind and our emotions. So it's important that we consider the qualities of the foods that we eat. So the gunas teach us that. The gunas say, first of all, you need food that is rich in prana. So avoid food that is recooked, that is overcooked, that is fast food, frozen food, you know, things that don't have much prana to it. And avoid food in which there is artificial things in it, chemicals, preservatives, additives. And avoid food that is too sharp or contrary in qualities, things that are too cold, too hot, so that the food will have a balancing effect upon the body, the nervous system, and then through its effect, the same effect will then be there upon the mind.